I feel it very sad. I mean, on one hand, the parties which call themselves as secular parties, if tomorrow BJP announces that the Prime Minister of India has to be a Hindu, then they will criticize BJP, you are a communal party, and India, Indian constitution doesn't differentiate between. And the same people, when it comes to Punjab or when it comes to Jammu and Kashmir, and maybe it comes to northeastern states, right, Nagaland or Meghalaya, they said that because Punjab state was created, the earlier Punjab was trifurcated, and they created a state so that the chief minister has to from the Sikh community.
Right.
And in the chief minister of Jammu and Kashmir has to be a Muslim and has to be from the valley, not just a Muslim, has to be from the valley.
Yes.
So this is, this is against the tenets of our constitution and this whole idea of secularism.
Namaste, everybody. Welcome to Chitti Media. My name is Sharan Sethi, your host. In today's current affairs talk, we will be talking about the Punjab political crisis. The Indian National Congress has very few states who have independent leaders who think freely from the high command of the Congress party. And now one such tall leader in Captain Amrinder Singh seems to have been shown the exit door. Now, this is a very serious political development in India. And joining us today is Anay Joglekar ji. He is a prominent television panelist on political and foreign affairs. So you may have seen him on television debates very regularly. So thank you so much for taking your time out for this. Namaskar.
Thank you, Sharan ji. It's a pleasure to talk to you.
Right. I know that you've been having a very, very busy day, but this is a very, very interesting political development. But before we get into the details of it, Anayji, could you tell us a brief background as to what was boiling in the last few weeks or months?
I would say that before coming to the current episode of Punjab politics, we have to understand that Punjab is a very important state in among Indian Federation. And the state has a 600-kilometer border with Pakistan. The state was created by partitioning India. And it was important decision, of Indian Sikhs to stay with India instead of demanding for a separate state. The state has suffered quite a lot because of terrorism and because of its border with Pakistan. Pakistan has been making numerous attempts to create unrest in the state. So that's why what happens in Punjab has implications at the national and international level.
Right.
We must say that Captain Amrinder Singh is a thorough gentleman. People may have differences between political parties, but because of his military background, because of his royal family background, he's among leaders who can get elected by himself, who can give a victory to Congress party. And if you look at the leadership of Congress party, Rahul Gandhi has been under his leadership, Congress is losing one state after another. And at this situation, you have someone like Amrinder Singh who gave victory in Punjab to Congress. And he's one of the few chief ministers in India from the opposition side who has not criticized Prime Minister Narendra Modi on the issue of national security and on the issue of foreign policy, when India made surgical strikes in Balakot or other issues. He refrained from criticizing, even on the farmers' protest issue. He has been very balanced in his criticism. Political differences are there and parties keep criticizing each other. So it is important that in the Congress party today, we have Rahul Gandhi, who will be president of Congress today or tomorrow. He was the president of Congress and he will be president of Congress. And since last two decades, he has been trying to make some changes in the Congress party. Maybe he is well-intentioned, but what he has tried so far has not delivered results. And in doing so, probably he thinks that he gets obstructed by the old guard of the Congress party, and Captain Amrinder Singh comes from that old guard who was schooled with Rajiv Gandhi. He was 1 year senior to Rajiv Gandhi. and he has very close ties with the Gandhi family, and he treats Rahul and Priyanka Gandhi as his own children. But Rahul Gandhi came up with this idea that all these old guard in the Congress, they are not allowing him to make any changes. And particularly after Ahmed Patel's death, or even before that, Rahul Gandhi has been trying to bring new leadership at the Congress level. It has not worked. And in Punjab, it was the one state where in many states, they allowed Rahul Gandhi to lead the state campaigns. But Punjab was the state where Captain Amrinder Singh led the campaign, and he delivered a rare victory to Congress. And so obviously he was supposed to be become chief minister. He became chief minister, but since then he is having problem with the young generation of the Congress, and particularly Rahul Gandhi camp. And it is a culture in Congress, I must say, that they don't like strong leaders in states. Right. And whenever there is a strong chief minister, they the Darbar politics tries to weaken the chief minister. And same thing happened in Congress. They did not have a very strong leader. And so they took Navjot Singh Sidhu. The difference between the older and younger generation of the Congress, Rahul Gandhi's Congress is trying to put Congress to a very left of center, more on the ideological grounds, vehemently opposing Prime Minister Narendra Modi, vehemently opposing the ideology of RSS and BJP and Swatantra Veer Savarkar. And so he needed people who can join him, who can criticize, you know, like BJP in that. And Captain Amrinder Singh is very mild-mannered and balanced person. So probably he, with that intention, he took Navjot Singh Sidhu in the party. Navjot Singh Sidhu was for almost more than a decade, almost he was part of BJP. He was a member of parliament from BJP. And so ideologically, he was inclined to BJP. But it looks like Navjot Singh Sidhu was an opportunist. And then he tried to be part of Aam Aadmi Party. He tried to launch his own political party. But Rahul Gandhi took him with that particular intention. And as a result, this kind of cold war was brewing between Navjot Singh Sidhu and Captain Amrinder Singh. Captain Amrinder Singh is 79. Probably he's fighting his last political battle. He's as Punjab is heading for elections in February 2022, probably the leadership of Congress thought this is a good opportunity to change the guard in the party. We are seeing that happen in different places in India because of COVID, because of other issues. Many chief ministers are finding it difficult because they are facing public criticism. So maybe the Congress leadership thought that it is time to change it. But the way it was done was not in good spirit.
Absolutely. I mean, the man has given so many years for the Congress party and the country. So the kind of exit that has been shown is absolutely dishonorable, is what you're trying to say. And, you know, what does Navjot Singh Sidhu represent to the Congress, or promise to the Congress, that they've made him a priority over somebody like Captain Amrinder Singh? Because I think he is the antithesis to what Captain Amrinder Singh is, especially if you look at fronts like foreign affairs and even national security for that matter. On one hand, you have a man who has served in the military for several years, and on the other hand, you have a man who is chilling with General Bajwa. So there are stark contrasts, right? Now, these political developments may have been because of internal politics within the Congress party. But Anayji, what it represents and what message it sends to the public is that the Congress party is clearly not concerned about, you know, who their leaders are aligned towards.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, Navjot Singh Sidhu was with BJP for more than a decade, but he was not driven by the BJP's or RSS core ideology. He was a popular VT personality. He was a cricketer. Even in the field of cricket, he was very aggressive. Then he had a stint as a judge, in the Laughter Challenge, in all kind of reality shows. But by doing so, what he knows or what he tries to do is always remain in the limelight. He does not have a very strong ideological bearing or character. And as a result, when he quit BJP, he could have stick to the ideology that he was representing in BJP, but he tried to pole vault and he tried to join Aam Aadmi Party. If you know, Aam Aadmi Party is trying to have a very different line in Punjab, which is very close to anti-national and even the soft secessionist Khalistanwadi line that Aam Aadmi Party is taking. So he tried to take that. He went to Punjab trying to show that all the Jats, whether in Pakistan or in India, and whether they are Muslims or Sikhs, they have like common culture, and they are but in doing so he hugged General Bajwa, which was insult to Punjabi people, because Punjab has suffered quite a lot in Pakistan sponsored terror. Many of the Congress leaders have died. They were assassinated by this Khalistani terrorist. Yes. And forgetting this, we should strive for good relations with our neighbor. But when our neighbor is trying every possible way to destabilize India, to create a Khalistani movement, rejuvenate Khalistani movement in India, that time you go there and you hug the chief of army staff there, this doesn't go down well. But still, I really don't understand what happened to Congress party. It should have shown some maturity while projecting Navjot Singh Sidhu. He promised Congress victory in Punjab. No doubt he is a charismatic person, but just being a charismatic person doesn't make you a suitable candidate to win elections and to govern the state, because in this Captain Amrinder Singh government, he was made a minister. But instead of doing his duties as ministers in politics, even if you are part of the same political party, not always you get what you aspire for, but even if you get a junior portfolio, if you get a different portfolio than what you get, you have to work because you have to serve the people. And instead of doing that, Navjot Singh Sidhu, despite being a minister in Punjab government, he was having a good life as on reality shows. So that shows what kind of character he had, and that should have been a message to Congress party. But unfortunately, the way he was brought in and the way this whole this agenda was run to oust Captain Amrinder Singh, the chief minister is a leader of legislative party. But when you don't invite, you don't inform chief minister that there is going to be a legislative party meeting, and then you do it at the dark of night. And then it's obvious that Captain Amrinder Singh feels humiliated, particularly someone who is so close to Gandhi family, who is so close to Sonia Gandhi. And as a result, what it has ended up, the whole script was written in a way that Navjot Singh Sidhu would be made as the next chief minister of Punjab, because he himself, I understand, opposed someone else being made chief minister, because he felt that already he has been contesting against Captain Amrinder Singh. And if you make someone for a 3 months or 4 months chief minister, you create another power center. So he was very much against it. But at the end of the day, you appointed someone and appointed a person who is not even known to many political commentators, like who is this Charanjit Singh Channi. And that shows like the kind of chaos within the organization of the Congress party. And the way names were thrown, the names in the afternoon, all of us were thinking that Mr. Randhawa is going to become chief minister of Punjab. And then this is not in good taste.
Right. Absolutely. Very good observation, sir. Thank you so much for that, Anayji. And like you rightly said, who is the new chief minister, Charanjit Singh Channi? Can you please give us a background about this? Because on one hand, some of the commentators on the other side of the spectrum are displaying this as some sort of a victory, because an unknown man, a common man from the Punjab Assembly, has been made the chief minister. And the other section is saying that he is a new Dalit face, so the dynamics are going to change. How do you observe this development?
It's very strange. The same people who were criticizing appointment of Mr. Bhupendra Patel as the new chief minister of Gujarat, that this is a high command culture. Same people are saying that this is the master stroke of a Congress to appoint someone who was not known. And then they are projecting that this is a Dalit chief minister. And this is like an empowerment of Dalits that Congress is doing. But we have to understand the ground reality of Punjab. It's unfortunate many of us are mostly know the caste combination, the caste politics in our own state, but who fail to understand how it works in other states. And many of us think that big Punjab being a Sikh majority state, there should not be any caste system or conflict between different castes. But it's very much in contrast to what we believe. Punjab, it is true that Punjab has almost 70% Sikhs and 30% Hindus. But Punjab has the highest percentage of Dalits in the in the society. And the Dalit community in Punjab is scattered. It is distributed among Sikhs as well as Hindus. Among Sikhs, there are mostly landless laborers. Like there are Jat Sikhs who are like zamindars and who are very well off. They are industrialists, whatever that cottage industries are in Punjab. And there are Dalit Sikhs which are distributed among different deras. Then there are Hindu Dalits who are again, there are people living in the cities and doing menial jobs in the city, like Valmikis are there. And then there are other Dalit Hindu Dalit communities in the villages. And even though Dalits are like more than 30%, which is much beyond their national average in any state, politically they are not very well organized.
Right.
Traditionally, Dalit people used to vote for Communist Party and because they used to talk about class struggle and poor people. And so because Dalit being poor people and landless people, they used to support Communist Party. So you see some base of Communist Party in Punjab. Then they started supporting BSP because the founder of BSP, Kanchiram, comes from Punjab and Dalit community. Mm-hmm. But again, that could not make a dent in Punjab, though BSP was very successful in Uttar Pradesh. But in Punjab, they could not. They used to get good amount of votes, but they could not make a dent in politics.
Right.
And traditionally, many Dalits have been voting to Congress. Even if you look at this legislature, from what I understand, there are out of the 34 seats which were reserved for Dalits, Congress won on 22 seats. And out of remaining 12 seats, I think if I'm not wrong, Aam Aadmi Party won 9 and Shiromani Akali Dal won only 3 seats.
Right.
So even though Congress got a majority of seats of which were reserved for Dalit, what Congress did is Congress gave just 2-3 ministries to Dalit people. And one of them is Charanjit Singh Channi.
Right.
And he was the one who criticized Captain Amrinder Singh for this under-representation of Dalit community within the Congress, Captain Amrinder Singh cabinet. So,
right.
But Congress party did not do anything that time. Even, I mean, generally the power is distributed like you appoint a Jat Sikh as a chief minister and then you appoint a Hindu as a Pradesh Congress president. But there also a Dalit was not appointed. Even when Navjot Singh Sidhu was made a party president, again, both places Jat Sikhs were there. So this whole story of empowering Dalits to become, it is sham. It
right.
is true that in last few months, the Dalit politics got a lot of traction in the state. BJP announced that if it wins the state, the new chief minister will be from Dalit community. Both Aam Aadmi Party and Shiromani Akali Dal, mm-hmm. they announced because Shiromani Akali Dal tied up with BSP because
right.
their alliance with BJP got over. They got with BSP and then they said that the deputy chief minister will be from BSP and he will be Dalit. And now they are saying that, oh, look, Congress, these people are just talking about making a Dalit chief minister or deputy chief minister, but Congress has actually delivered. But everyone knows that this Mr. Channi is going to be chief minister only for more or less 3 months. After that, the elections will be declared. And Congress has not dared to declare that he will be the chief minister if Congress wins the elections. So everybody knows that he is like a stopgap chief minister. And the way they will announce the cabinet tomorrow, they will try to balance it out with Jat Sikhs and Hindus. In a way, and everybody knows that even though Mr. Channi becomes chief minister, the steering will be in the hands of Navjot Singh Sidhu. And so I'm not sure whether people will buy this argument that Congress, by appointing Mr. Channi as chief minister, has taken a great step to empower Sikhs. If they really want to do that, they should have announced that Mr. Channi will be chief minister and he will lead the Congress in the elections
right.
and he will be chief minister if Congress is victorious. But that looks less likely.
Oh, that's fantastic analysis, Anayaji. I mean, it's an eye-opening thing for even us, a lot of people, and I'm sure our audience will find this very, very interesting. Now, Ambika Soni ji was also one of the top runners for the chief minister's post. Now, what happened all of a sudden? Do you think there are different dynamics or involved because she wanted a Sikh to be a chief minister? But now, is this true? And what? How do you analyze this statement?
I feel it very sad. I mean, on one hand, the parties which call themselves as secular parties, if tomorrow BJP announces that the Prime Minister of India has to be a Hindu, then they will criticize BJP, you are a communal party and India, Indian constitution doesn't differentiate between. And the same people when it comes to Punjab or when it comes to Jammu and Kashmir and maybe it comes to northeastern states, right. Nagaland or Meghalaya, they said that because Punjab state was created, you know, the earlier Punjab was trifurcated and they created a state so that the chief minister has to from the Sikh community.
Right.
And in the chief minister of Jammu and Kashmir has to be a Muslim and has to be from the valley, not just a Muslim, has to be from the valley.
Yes.
So this is, I mean, this is against the tenets of our constitution and this whole idea of secularism.
Right.
But this reason was given by Ambika Soni ji that she cannot be chief minister because the chief minister has to be from the Sikh community. It's sad. Saying this, it's a reality that most likely the chief minister of Punjab is from Sikh community. They are in the numerically they are very Sikh community is 70%, so nothing wrong in it. But the way it was said, that that is not right. And in doing so, I mean, again, Ambika Soni, what are her credentials? What is her contribution for Punjab Congress Party's performance?
Mm-hmm.
This, whether it is Sunil Jakhad or whether it is Ambika Soni, they are both of them are they are Darbari right. politicians, and I believe that this is a reason why Congress has come down to such a as a weak party, because yes. instead of encouraging strong leaders at the state level, Congress has been creating a mess, like creating a cold war in state. You appoint a chief minister, then you appoint a person from his opposite camp as a party president, and you have some Prabhari sitting in Delhi who is from another camp, and high command keeps watching the fight between these three leaders. And in between, the governance suffers, and in between, the organization of Congress suffers. It was okay when Congress was right. the only party and BJP was not strong enough to challenge it. But now you have BJP as a principal political party in India. And now there are a lot of parties, including Trinamool Congress, Aam Aadmi Party, when they are challenging Congress and you are still doing this old school politics, it is not fair. Right. So what Ambika Soni said, it is part of that Congress organizational culture. But I believe that Congress will have to change it if it wants to have a good Achhe Din in Indian politics.
Right. You bring up some very, very pertinent points, Anirji. And if I may ask you a small follow-up, and I know that you've had a very long day, and after this we will conclude, I promise. Now, if we look at the national parties or even regional parties in Punjab, there seems to be a huge leadership vacuum, especially with what has happened today. Whether it's the Indian National Congress or whether it's the Aam Aadmi Party, if you remember the last election, the incident where Arvind Kejriwal declared himself to be the chief ministerial candidate and then that sort of backfired on them, or whether it is the state of BJP unable to find a chief minister face in Punjab, why is this happening and what is the solution going ahead?
I believe that, BJP has a very long way to go in Punjab, because the reason is ideologically, whether it is RSS point of view, The whole history of Punjab and the whole history of Sikhism has to, you know, like even though it stands on a merit, because of what happened post independence for many years, seven decades, BJP will have to first create space for itself to, right. to make people believe that what RSS point of view about the history of Sikhism was the role of Sikhism gets accepted by the people of Punjab, because for decades what was taught and the Sikh community was created as a separate religious identity, and then because of separatism BJP will have to do some things to bridge the gap.
Right.
BJP was in alliance with Shiromani Akali Dal for many years, almost 25 years almost same amount of time as it was in alliance with Shiv Sena. And that alliance was based on understanding, because Shiromani Akali Dal was weakened because of this Khalistani movement, and they also wanted to re-establish themselves. And to defeat Congress, this alliance formed on a ground that Shiromani Akali Dal contested mostly in the Sikh-dominated constituencies, while BJP contested in the Hindu-dominated. BJP is a national party. BJP cannot limit itself only to Hindu-dominated seats. But because of the compulsion of alliance politics, the Shiromani Akali Dal did not allow BJP to get into Sikh majority or Sikh dominated seats. Like Shiv Sena in Maharashtra did not allow BJP to get into Mumbai, where Marathi dominated seats in Mumbai, because that was core vote bank of Shiv Sena. So BJP mostly played as a younger partner in the state. And what happened is Shiromani Akali Dal, at one point, for many decades, it was a religious, the political parties has its roots in the religious hierarchy in the system. But over a period of time, it became a family party, and it lost its relevance. It was ridden by corruption and nepotism. And it started losing against Congress in the state. And BJP, it became a liability for BJP. So BJP, right, in a way, After Narendra Modi became Prime Minister and BJP got a solid majority, it tried to create a space for itself in the state of Punjab. And that, as a result, Shiromani Akali Dal made an issue of this farmer protest and farmer law, and it broke the alliance, because it realized that BJP is going to push them into a corner. So now BJP is on its own. BJP has a challenge that because of this farmers' protest, BJP is on back foot in Punjab. These laws are good for India, but in Punjab, because of decades of pampering to farmers who participated in Green Revolution, it is difficult politically to support farm laws and get elected in Punjab. So BJP has to expand its voter base beyond Hindus and get into Sikh-dominated regions. They did not have many Sikh leaders. Navjot Singh Sidhu was one, but now he is not in BJP. They want to have a convincing, answers about these farm laws, how they are going to benefit to farmers in Punjab. Because it's an emotional issue. I mean, on merit, BJP is right, but it is an emotional issue. And so BJP has to go a long way. But in between, BJP can definitely take advantage of this political uncertainty, the decline in Congress. And BJP can create itself a base in Punjab among Punjabi Hindus and also Dalits. And slowly BJP can expand its footprint. But that's why, because BJP always remained in the second fiddle. And the difference between Punjab and Maharashtra, as I said, Maharashtra, even though BJP was a junior partner, The demography of Maharashtra is different than Punjab. Maharashtra is a Hindu-dominated state. And while Punjab, because of Shiromani Akali Dal's special stature among Sikh community, BJP could not make inroads into it. So I don't see a very bright future for BJP in the upcoming elections. But this is a good opportunity for BJP to because it's a slug fight in between different political parties. Aam Aadmi Party has lost its way. Because why Aam Aadmi Party lost is because Arvind Kejriwal was chief minister. He got a very big majority. But at the end of the day, he was chief minister of a half state. Right. If Aam Aadmi Party had won in Punjab, the chief minister of Punjab could have been much more powerful than Aam Aadmi Party. And that's why he wanted to be chief minister of Punjab, or he could not figure out how to handle this. And they lost it. And now since then, and they also took support from all these Khalistan sympathizers. And that also did not go down well with many voters. So right now, in this situation of uncertainty, I believe that it's good opportunity for BJP. BJP has been there to play a game in the long term. And so BJP can, see the low-hanging fruits in Punjab politics. Maybe Hindus and Dalit communities and certain Sikh voters, and can strengthen its base.
Right. You're absolutely true in what you say, because if a party that is associated with Operation Blue Star and emergency can make a re-emergence just after a few years in Punjab, and it continues to be a successful dominant political party in Punjab, the RSS has a history of saving Sikhs during partition, and it goes a long way. So does the BJP, especially with its nationalistic agenda on hand. This has been extremely interesting, Anaji. I mean, for me also personally, I've learned a lot from this. You have not just very astutely analyzed the current situation in Punjab, but you've given us a future projection, a historical analysis as well. Thank you so much. I'm sure this is going to be watched by thousands of people.
Thank you, Sharanjit. It was a pleasure talking to you. And let's hope whatever happens in Punjab happens in the interest of India, and they get a good and strong government for the time.
Absolutely. We hope the same too. And it's always a pleasure to talk to you. And I hope you can join us again.
Yes, we'll try my best.
Namaste, ji. Thank you. And to all our viewers, please do like, share and subscribe to Chitti Media. We will be bringing you updates from Punjab as political events unfold. Until then, this is your host, Sharan Sethi, signing off.
Please remember to subscribe to us and switch on the notifications for this channel. For our other social media links, more content and to support our work, please visit citti.net. Dhanyavaad. Namaskar.